good morning. It's great to be back here speaking at the American Atheist Convention. I was last here in 2014 when you were meeting in Salt Lake City. A lot of things have happened in the atheism movement that I have observed since that time. In fact, the philosophy has obviously proven so powerful that even Utah's Senator Orrin Hatch finally decided to retire. Now, and you should, see, you should take full credit for that, because of following the lead of our president in Washington, you should take credit for everything that happens that you like. Now, at that time, by the way, you were just launching Atheist Television, and it took until 3 weeks ago for the Church of Scientology to launch Scientology Television. Now, why did they do that? I mean, I don't know for sure, but I bet it's because Scientologists are now more unpopular than you are. Now, for me, I'm still a theist, although I must admit it becomes increasingly difficult for me to even comprehend the activities of many of my fellow theists. For example, how about holding a church service in Newfoundland, Pennsylvania, it's in the Pocono Mountains, to celebrate reaffirming your marriage vows and affirming AR-15 assault rifles. Wait a minute, why would they do that? Because the book of Revelation, as some of you know better than Baptists, is a reference, that's true, you know that. Book of Revelation talks about the power of iron. Obviously a gun reference. Now you people, no, really, you folks wouldn't even support that idea if part of the agenda of the service was shooting angels out of the sky. No, and then wait, but that pales in comparison to this. Hundreds of thousands of Christians have now signed a petition to have the birthday of the late Reverend Billy Graham declared a national holiday. Why? Why? Because in their view, Billy Graham converted more people to Christianity than anyone in history. Look, converting people to anything does not justify creating a national holiday for you. I don't see, you're not trying to create a national holiday for Christopher Hitchens' birthday or Madeline Murray O'Hare's birthday. And in fact, maybe. Look, let me put it this way. You folks wouldn't be in favor of creating a national holiday for the Reverend Jerry Falwell, even though he's probably responsible for creating more atheists than anybody on the planet. Now, when I say it's great to be here, I don't mean it's just great to be here because I really like you people, or because Dave Silverman is such a great leader in support of the First Amendment. Those are true. But I mean it's great to be here physically because I'm not dead. Yeah. And this, yeah. So I retired in November after 25 years of serving as executive director of Americans United for Separation of Church and State. And thank you. And to celebrate that, along with the 75th anniversary of the foundation of the organization, we had one of those galas in Washington. You know, we celebrate. I've been to hundreds of those things, and frankly, most of them I don't like. So at the very first planning meeting, I said, we have got to do this one differently. And the first thing, we got to get the right MC, because we can't use a former local news anchor who will tell terrible jokes. That is not going to happen. A couple of years ago, I met Lewis Black. We'd become good friends. I said, Lewis, would you do this? And of course, he said yes. That was a good start. We had music. I know a lot of singers. We had two wonderful women singer-songwriters and a lot of the great activists that I've known not only at Americans United, but also prior to that at the ACLU, who spoke on my behalf. And David showed up along with 400 or so other people and asked me at the end if I'd come back and speak to you again. And of course I said yes. Now, at that event, a lot of people said something like this: "Hey Barry, it must be great to hear all these good things people are saying about you, and you're not even at your funeral." Now, you wouldn't say that. And because when you die, you don't think somebody's watching a funeral. For those of us who are theistically inclined, we're open to the possibility that if we ended up in a place like heaven, we might see what's going on at our funeral, but not necessarily from a good seat. So, well, 3 weeks after that event, after all the comments about the funeral, I had a heart attack. And I had 4 surgical interventions between then and now. But I'm here. I just think it's an advice. Do not link retirement with a near-death experience. It is very bad. And before you even ask, wait a minute. In all that time, did you see God? No. I didn't even see a bright light followed by deceased relatives and David Bowie. I didn't see any of that. I did have one thing though, an image. My wife said I was out at one point for 36 hours under anesthesia. And coming out of it, I had this image. It was of I was trapped inside of a giant sphere with holes in it. Kind of envision a giant wiffle ball. I couldn't get out of it. I could get my foot out of it. That's the most. That's it, folks. That's all I noticed. That's all I know about a precursor to any afterlife. So your non-belief is still secure. I'm not trying to convert you. So for a couple of weeks, I had to get used to a pacemaker, with which I am 100% dependent. I had a replacement with cow tissue of an aortic valve in my heart and my entire carotid artery. Now, what irritated me, all those parts of cows in me, I still can't give milk. Worse than that, when I woke up from these operations, I had blurred vision and I couldn't speak at all. I couldn't make a sound. So as you can hear, I have a little problem making a sound now. But you should have not heard me when I just got out of the hospital. Apparently one of the 21 tubes in my body at one point hit a nerve that innervates, among other things, the vocal cords. And it'll be a long time before it comes back. This is the first speech I've wanted to give since I got out. You know, over these first 3.5 months or so of getting out of hospitals, I realized I have no obligations during that period except to go see nurses, doctors, therapists of various kinds. I had no obligations. I didn't have to write anything. I was retired. I didn't have to go on television. I was retired. I didn't have to do anything. And I wasn't linked to any organization anymore. Not that I don't love the ACLU and Americans United, but I was free of having to care what they thought about anything. And that's a liberating thought. That's a kind of freedom I haven't had in my entire life. Thanks to the internet, of course, I could just spout off about anything. I could put up Facebook things about hospitalization and you know, get comments on it. All is a good thing. I could be trolled. I could even be a troll. That was pretty good. All these liberating thoughts. What I wanted to share with you this morning is the title of this speech. Says I wanted to share what I've learned about politics and culture in that period of time when I was subjected mainly to watching television, which I don't do and I haven't done for the last 25 years. I go to the movies, so I don't go. Fundamentally, what I found out, I was increasingly distressed about the cowardice of people in power. I know a singer who died not too long ago. I know a lot of singers named Utah Phillips, who came from Utah, and some of you actually do know who he is. And we became friendly, and he was a socialist candidate for the U.S. Senate in Utah, ran against Orrin Hatch unsuccessfully. But he was primarily a singer and a songwriter and a storyteller and a union organizer. In 1996, he did two records with Ani DiFranco, who was at the time becoming a real powerful force in the feminist movement. And I once said to him, Bruce, that was his actual name, Bruce, I said, does it frustrate you that after working so hard, doing all this great stuff for most of your life, it takes your collaboration with this up-and-coming star to get the kind of improved recognition that you should have had? And he said, more sagely, I think, than I can repeat it this morning, he said, when you have an effect on a few people, when you have a small bubble of influence, you still have a responsibility to take care of the people you have an influence over and to treat them right and to make the world better for them. And then, when you get a sudden influx of more influence, you get that bigger circle of influence, and then your responsibility grows too. And I thought, that's a hell of a good thing to say. And I wish everybody believed it. And a lot of people in the media and a lot of people in politics apparently don't believe that. I think the media in this country stinks. It stinks. I get to the point where I even began to watch more of Fox News than other outlets because they don't even claim anymore that they're fair and balanced. You notice they drop? No, they drop that logo because they're not. They're just right-wing nuts. Now, they don't say that, but that's what they are. I get particularly disgusted with CNN because they are so damn self-righteous. In fact, I blame CNN along with latent racism, complete sexism, half the staff of Hillary Clinton for her defeat. Now, why do I say that? CNN, Bill Maher, Jake Tapper on, made this accusation. They gave so much time to Trump. Jake said, well, we did at the beginning. No, that's what Rick Santorum taught me, this word bullshit. That's bullshit. No, it's bullshit. When they were in the closing weeks of the campaign, if you're watching CNN and they're going to regular news, by which I mean the same 12 people talking about what could happen, they would cut away only to the Donald Trump campaign rallies. What did they think he was going to do? Come up with an idea? No. No. And I'd speculate, this is just speculation, but I'd speculate they were just afraid of not being live when there was some act of violence that occurred at the Trump rally. They didn't want to miss it. And following the election, of course, CNN began tinkering with its schedule a bit. There's a brief period when the aforementioned Jake Tapper got a new primetime show. Who was his very first guest? Kellyanne Conway. I knew her. So I've been in Washington long enough. I knew her since she was Kellyanne Fitzpatrick and before she had 17 children or whatever she has. Then Jake complains on air and afterwards for days about how she's just making stuff up. What, had he not seen her before? I mean, this is the woman that went on Meet the Press and tried to rebrand lying as using alternative facts. This is the woman who created the Bowling Green Massacre. What was he thinking? You know, if you're the host of a show, you get to pick the guests. You get to pick the guests. Why did he pick her? And then why did he moan about it for so long afterwards? Hosts ought to be able to know that anytime you have somebody with a political point of view, they're going to do a little spinning. They're going to marshal evidence as much as they can on their side of an issue. But there's a difference between spinning and just making shit up. Really. And that doesn't help anybody. That literally doesn't do anybody any good, doesn't elevate any debate or discussion. So Tapper continued that week. Didn't last too many weeks. They had Rick Santorum on. He's a paid CNN consultant. How tough is that to get? Rick Santorum and I had a lot of fights when he was in the Senate, as you can imagine, over church and state. And then after he ran for the presidency, he became a movie producer. Perhaps you don't know that. So he decides to make a movie called One Generation Away, how we're one generation away from losing our religious freedom. He calls me up, says, hey, will you be in the movie? I said, yeah, but there are two hesitations. I said, one, I want somebody from Americans United to be in there with me. And number two, I want you to bring a makeup artist because I can use all the help I can get. And they said, yeah, we'll do both of those things. Well, the movie's made, comes out. It's premiered at the Heritage Foundation. I'm not invited. That's okay, I don't get invited to the Oscars either, so it's not a big deal. But the press was invited, and so I decided to look at some of the reportage afterwards. And one person says to Santorum, why did you have any critics of the war on Christianity perspective in the film? And he said, well, they scare me so much, I wish you had put in more of their comments. Now, that's good. Now, I only watched 20 minutes of this film. I don't know if Dave is in the film. Dan Barker and I were in the film in the first 20 minutes. And I'm glad we scared him. I don't believe that they would have had more of us in, but who knows. Rick Santorum, you know, back in the news this week when he suggested that instead of young people organizing about gun violence, it would be better if they learned CPR. And really, that's what he said. And then he kind of quasi-apologized for it. He meant it the first time. You know, when people apologize, just assume they meant it the first time. So I'm frequently annoyed, CNN. What about the rest of the media? What about MSNBC? I have returned to being on this panel with a bunch of actual comedians on SiriusXM's John Fugelsang show. If you don't listen to that, he is really good. He's really smart. If you don't subscribe to SiriusXM, you should, because of John and because of Neil deGrasse Tyson, and because they now have an entire channel devoted to Lynyrd Skynyrd. And then one of the people that's usually on this panel is Frank Conniff. And some of you know Frank. He shows up at non-theist events every once in a while. He was the founder of the good version of Mystery Science Theater 3000. And he properly pointed out a couple weeks ago when I was on the show, he said, you know, by MSNBC spending a lot of time on the Russia connection, that's really important, but what are we missing by spending so much time talking about Russia? And that was a good question. And there is an answer to it. At the time, Congress was debating the big spending bill that they finally had the president sign about, I think, this time last week. And look at the things that were buried in that bill originally that didn't make it in the final cut, but people were pleading for it. The elimination of what Nick talked about, the Johnson Amendment, talk a little bit more about that. This is the idea that churches should be able to endorse political candidates and giving them an incredible amount of additional raw power. Secondly, there was the people pleading for a provision that would allow any medical personnel the so-called right to impose their religious beliefs on patients, as in refusing to schedule an abortion if the scheduler, who's medical personnel, doesn't believe in abortion. Reciprocity for openly carrying handguns across state lines, even into states that don't approve of open carry. These are the kinds of things that were being debated. I didn't see much of anything about any of that during all the deliberation about Russia over the last couple of months, and all the deliberation, of course, over Stephanie Clifford. You know who she is. Stormy. The Stephanie Clifford Stormy Daniels story is highly covered. And by the way, I hope she brings him down. I do. And this is why. There's so many reasons. I saw a clip of a panel from CNN last Sunday night, all women who had voted for Donald Trump. And they were being asked, they watched this segment on 60 Minutes, and then they were asked, what do you think now? Nobody changed their mind. And you know what the biggest reason was? She is a stripper and a porn star, and he's the president of the United States. That is one hell of a justification. I am sick of how men and women in this culture of both patriarchy and super sexism have the audacity to say to anyone, just because they happen to be in it, related to the sex business, that they're untrustworthy and not good people. I'm sure that Stephanie Clifford wishes she were offered the jobs that Meryl Streep got, and I'm sure that she wishes Daddy had given her $1 million to start a business. But that's not the way the world functions. That is not the way it functions. Why, by the way, I saw a poll 2 days ago. I don't know how reliable this is. If you run Donald Trump, I'm not making this up, you run Donald Trump against Stephanie Clifford, Stephanie Clifford wins by 1%. If you run Stormy Daniels, Trump wins by 4 points. Why'd they wait so long to air that interview on 60 Minutes? They aired it last Sunday. It had been cut and edited at least 2 weeks before. There was a threat on the part of the Trump administration to sue CBS if they ran the interview. Now, that's called prior restraint. Courts do not like prior restraint. So why would CBS sit on this for 2 weeks, even though no one had even filed a lawsuit against CBS for possibly airing it? I could be wrong, but I just say, my guess is just spinelessness. Absolutely. It's just spinelessness. Yes, well, so what do you do in this context? What do you do? Well, in the hospital, they have really lousy televisions. They're really small. I didn't see that well at the time. And also, it always seems to be airing the same thing. There are all these fake judges. You know, three of them. And Judge Judy's the most highly paid person in the media. I just discovered that this week. Judge Judy. She only works 52 days a year. And she makes a multi-million dollar salary. Hundreds of millions. Anyway, I listen to podcasts. I started to go to podcasts, and I really like podcasts. I like the thinking atheists, the nonprofits, the friendly. And now I mentioned three, but that doesn't mean I don't like the others. I just listened. I had to stop somewhere. And then I was really interested in the fact that David Letterman, who I've never met, but who seems like a really clever guy, was going to have a podcast on Netflix. And I was pretty excited about that until I discovered the name of it. The name of it is My Next Guest Needs No Introduction. And indeed, the first two interviewees he had were Barack Obama, George Clooney. I understand he's doing Jay-Z next week. I mean, he's right. They don't need any introduction. In fact, anything they do makes news, international headlines, what Barack Obama thinks about anything. So I was wondering why were we doing that? And I thought, you know, I would like to... I'd like to do my own podcast, and I was planning to do it. And when I heard about Letterman's, I wanted to call mine. The guy that I'm working with, though, said it's too long a title. If the worlds of politics and culture were fairer, my next guest wouldn't need an introduction, but unfortunately, she does. I think. Because what I love about podcasting, which is hugely important, it's getting to be more important than talk radio. It's so important. I want to hear different voices. I want to hear new people. There's so many people in the world of law and music and culture and politics and organizing that you'd never see on television. I want to hear them on podcasts. That's the point. So listen to podcasts, make your own. There's so many deficiencies in the mainstream media. Just turn it off. It's so repetitive, honestly, that the same breaking news sometimes breaks for 36 hours. 36 hours. It's important to listen to the other side, because if you don't listen to the other side, even the other side's podcasts, you don't have a way to understand what they think their best arguments are. And then whether you're having a formal debate or you're just having a chat with your brother-in-law, you're not going to be able to be prepared to hear even what to you may be ridiculous arguments on the other side of any issue. Other thing that bothers me about the media, why do they give up so quickly? Kathy Griffin, I'm not a huge Kathy Griffin fan, but remember last fall when she put up that picture of this cut-off head of Donald Trump? It was national outcry. My God, this is horrible. She lost her co-hosting gig for New Year's Eve with Anderson Cooper. She was virtually unemployable in any comedy club or theater in this country until just about now. She effectively became an entertainment non-entity. Now, was that photograph tasteless? I don't know. Because she's, no, really, she's a comedian. That's what she does. She deals in hyperbole and ridicule, excess. That's what comedians do. Trump is the president of the United States. He ought to be able to take a little bit of criticism, even if he thinks it's over the top, because of the power imbalance there. He's the guy who said during the presidential campaign, I could walk down Fifth Avenue in New York City and shoot somebody, I wouldn't lose any support. So what are people worried about with Kathy Griffin's picture? Were they worried that people would become copycats, and instead of just putting up an image, they'd actually cut Donald Trump's head off? Or what about the vaunted children? What about the influence on the children? I don't know. You know, children become the excuse for a lot of things. I think, you know, you can't reduce the whole population of America to what's acceptable to see or read or hear for children. You can't do that. You can't run a country that way. And by the way, if children are that malleable, if they're that convertible, wouldn't they be more likely to go, the president said he could shoot somebody on the street and get away with it? than be influenced by a comedian they probably have never heard of? I think not. But you know, when that happened, it was so easy. Joy Behar the other day on The View, Whoopi Goldberg, Sonny Hostin, she said that somebody had said Mike Pence speaks the words he hears from God. And she said she can understand wanting to talk to God, but that if you think you're speaking as public policy, the words of God, she referred to that as hearing voices or perhaps mental illness. Now, you would have thought she'd torn up one of the Dead Sea Scrolls on the air because there was so much, 36,000 people phoned ABC or its sponsors of that show and said, fire her, fire her. So in 10 days later, Joy apologized. She apologized. We are really sensitive these days.
Yep.
2 weeks ago, when the deputy director of the FBI, Andrew McCabe, was fired by Jeff Sessions one day before he became eligible for his federal pension, Fox News, a favorite former governor of Arkansas, Mike Huckabee, tweeted, it was a great decision to fire him, and although he wouldn't get his pension, he would be, quote, getting free passage in an overhead bin on a United flight back home. That was a reference to 3 days earlier when a couple had their English bulldog stuffed into a United overhead rack where it died en route. There wasn't much complaint about that. I'm not sure you have to complain about every single thing. We've got to learn to live with things. But when there's this huge power imbalance, you know, that's when you probably ought to complain. And that's why I'm not at all upset that Laura Ingraham has lost so many advertisers for making so much light out of that's the media. I'm just about at the end. I want to talk a little about politicians. I do respect some politicians. I've known some great ones. I was really proud to be able to vote for the first time I voted for president, to vote for Congresswoman Shirley Chisholm from New York. I was so glad to know people like the late Phil Hart, Senator Hart of Michigan. Senator Hart of Michigan said to me once, when I asked him about why he took on so many controversial issues, he said, sometimes you just have to do the right thing, just because it's the right thing to do. There aren't so many of those people around. As Nick mentioned, there are only two major politicians. I would add a third, Jamie Raskin, who represents my part of Maryland, very close to, he is a humanist. He's proud to say that. I don't know if he uses the A word or not. I did tell him once, though, that he was so damn good on issues. I wish he was wrong on something so I could organize a protest in my own hometown. Remember that debate, endless debate over the House Intelligence Committee and its report over whether the federal intelligence surveillance, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, had decided using properly to investigate that obscure Trump official, Carter Page. There was a period when the committee decided only to release the Republican version of its report, no Democratic version of the report at all. Democratic ranking member of the committee is California Congressman Adam Schiff. He appeared, according to a study on Fox News, 227 times, bemoaning the fact that the Republicans got their version cleaned up and released. The Democrats at that point weren't even having it released at all. And I like Adam Schiff. He's a good guy. He's very articulate, well-spoken. Is there nothing he could have done, though, but complain about it? And the answer is yes, he could have. He could have done what Mike Gravel did back in the 1970s with something called the Pentagon Papers. Mike was a senator from Alaska. He was the chair of a subcommittee on congressional buildings and grounds. And on June the 29th of 1971, he convened that subcommittee, read into the record the beginnings of the of the Pentagon Papers that chronicled the whole history of the deceit that got us into Vietnam and kept us there. He then asked for unanimous consent that the entire Pentagon Papers document be printed in the Congressional Record. This was one day, if you saw the movie The Post, one day before the Supreme Court decided that newspapers, including the New York Times and The Post, could print the Pentagon Papers. So even if that decision had gone wrong, because of the courage of Mike Gravel, it still would have seen the light of day. It still would have seen the light of day. So the Democrats on the Intelligence Committee, they could have been walked out in the hall anytime with their, they wrote the 10-page report. They could have walked out there and just read it to the press. Now, would that have upset people? Laura Ingraham, Tucker Carl, they would have been very upset. They're upset now. They couldn't get more upset. Could have seen the unredacted version. And eventually we saw a redacted version. Even Jeff Sessions, with his version of the Constitution, which I think he found in a sock drawer. But he knows there's something called the speech or debate clause. It prohibits, absolutely prohibits, prosecuting a member of Congress for anything that she or he does in the course of their conduct in office. That would have protected against everything but the blowback from Fox. I did lobbying for the ACLU for a very long time. Before I started with Americans United, there were Republicans and Democrats at that time who understood the minutia of rules of the House and Senate, and they really understood them. Lowell Weicker used to tell me repeatedly, he was a Republican senator from Connecticut, you know, Barry, it's not the Supreme Court, it's the Senate that is the last great protector of the rights of the people. And that's because he used the filibuster. And he knew how to do it, and he used it well. And he never let things happen that he disapproved of. And he knew the rules. He didn't just object to pieces of legislation or sections of legislation that were in big omnibus bills that he didn't like. He would filibuster the motions to proceed to consideration of the bill, which you can also filibuster. Neil Gorsuch got on the court, made terrible decisions at the end of last term, because even though you can't filibuster a nomination for a federal court anymore, you could have done more. The people in the Senate could have done a hell of a lot more than they did in letting Neil Gorsuch get through. I'm worried about Donald Trump. I'm not just worried about Donald Trump on a daily or hourly basis for the things he does and says. I'm worried about the fact that he wants to destroy the institutions of this country. He wants to destroy voting in this country. And when Nick talked about the need to vote, and I agree with every single thing he said that you need to do, this administration wants to make it more difficult for you to register to vote, wants to make it more difficult for you to get to the polls to vote. There are lots of cosmic changes I'd love to see. I wish we had a national holiday for voting. I wish we'd get away. But you do away with that. You do away with all art. He has zeroed out the National Endowment for the Arts. He zeroed out public radio and public television. I mean, Donald Trump doesn't want art to be funded. He doesn't want art. What does he want art? I mean, I know there's a movie theater in, there's one rumor, I'm just about out of time, but one rumor, John Bolton, I've known him forever too. And he wants to, I'm worried that he's going to go in and say, Mr. President, I'd suggest you go see the film Black Panther, because it's another example of a good place we could invade and seize their vibranium Look, I'm out of time, but I wanted to close with something. I said this to you the last time I was here. It's not your fault that people do not want to hear from atheists. That's our fault. That's why even Dr. King, he was happy to have a Catholic priest, a Jewish rabbi, and himself and other ministers in front of those civil rights marches. But you were there. I know you were there. And you tell me everywhere I went with Americans United, people would say, you're there. You were there. It's just that you weren't always recognized. Justice Louis Brandeis said a lot of brilliant things. And one of the things that I've been thinking about the most in the times that I've been recovering here was one line. He said, the greatest menace to freedom is an inert people. Atheists are not inert people. You walk the walk, you spin the spin, you are everywhere. You need, as Nick said, to be clear who you are when you speak. But you do more than most of these groups that are out there, religious or otherwise, to make sure that we have a country and indeed a world that is better than the one we inherited it. I thank you for all the work you do. And I thank you for having me back here today. Thank you.